It's 8 o'clock. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome on behalf of the North Africa and Middle East Department of the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Warm welcome here to the Rode Hoed. Very glad to see so many familiar faces here tonight. We are a full house tonight, so it's a very popular topic which we are addressing. The topic of tonight, as you saw in the invitation, is projected here: breaking news or breaking truth, mass media and politics in the Middle East. My name is Ernesto Braam. There's a lot of discussion about objectivity of the news media in the Middle East. How independent are they? How much bias is there? Are they a tool of the government in the Middle East? Earlier this year, Der Spiegel published an article with the title, "After the Arab Spring, Al Jazeera Losing Battle for Independence." Several top journalists left Al Jazeera, and it was claimed that this was because of the political agenda of this network. Now, Al Jazeera's biggest competitor, Al Arabiya, immediately seized the opportunity and also published an article, of course, to rub it in, where it was claiming that about 22 Al Jazeera staff quit because they claimed they had a bias in favor of the Muslim Brotherhood. Of course, Al Jazeera denies this. Now, last month, the Al Jazeera office in Egypt was closed down by the Egyptian government. Hamas in Gaza shut down the Al Arabiya office. So a lot is happening on the side of the media. There's really a dynamic situation, an interaction between the mass media and politics and politicians in the Middle East. Now tonight we have two speakers here with us on the stage who will enlighten us about the ins and outs of the mass media, and maybe other media too, in the Middle East and North Africa. We first will have Marwan Kraidy, Professor Kraidy, and then after that Wadah, Khanfar, and we will be joined later, if of course the technique works, but I'm sure, I'm very confident, by Skype, by two other participants in the discussion. You will hear about that later. The first speaker will be Professor Marwan Kraidy. He's a professor of communications at the famous Annenberg School of Communication at the University of Pennsylvania. He had, before, he was at the Edward Said Chair of American Studies at the American University of Beirut, and he is a very prolific writer. He's written, I think, more than 100 essays. I haven't counted them, all of them, but it says in the CV. Written 6 books, including a book with the title of Reality TV in the Arab and Arab Politics, which received several prizes for the quality and the depth of the book. And he also wrote a book which I by chance read with the title Arab Television Industries. Now in this book, it's a very interesting book, so I recommend it to all of you who want to know more about Arab television. He writes about the metamorphosis of Arab television and the political implications. He writes about trends and competition between Al Jazeera and Al Arabiya. And interesting to know, if you don't get a chance to talk to Marwan Kraidy tonight, he will be here next year, the whole year, to write a book in the Netherlands, and he will be a fellow of the Netherlands Institute of Advanced Studies. Now, Professor Kraidy will talk about the politicization of the media in the Middle East and North Africa. Now, my usual remarks, please switch off the tune, at least, of your phone. You don't have to switch off your phones. And as always, whatever the speakers here or later by Skype will say does not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Nor does it contradict them necessarily. Occasionally it does, but they won't tell you when. Now, Professor Kraidy, without any further ado, please take the floor.
Thanking the Ministry for Foreign Affairs for inviting me to be here. I'm very honored to speak to you, to share the stage with my esteemed colleagues, the electronic stage. And I'd like to start with a little story, or a joke, really. Two men once stumbled out of a bar, and they had had a few drinks, and they started arguing. And one of them pointed to the sky and said, "This is the moon." And the other one looked at the same sky and said, "No, this is the sun. This is the moon, this is the sun. This is the sun, this is the moon." Until they saw a third guy and they called him in as witness. And they said, "Sir, could you please help us out here? Is this the sun or the moon?" And the man said, "I'm sorry, gentlemen, I'm not from around here." Now, what does this tell us about the battles of representation that are raging as we speak around the Arab Spring? What does this joke tell us a little bit about the Arab media? I would venture to say that, first of all, one of the main things I'm going to argue in the 10 minutes I have tonight with you is to say that most people covering the story are saying this is neither the sun, neither the moon. This is the planet that I think it is, that I believe it should be. And I will make the argument that, in fact, there's a fundamental shift in the information environment that has been occurring around the globe, that has been more specific, more acute, more intense in the Arab world, that has been shaping up over decades, so that we are at a point now where the most important thing, because of a variety of economic, political, ideological pressures, is less conveying an accurate representation of the truth and more being trapped into conveying a narratives, one version of events unfolding. So let's step back a little bit and consider the historical development of Arab media and how the field of media in the Arab world has related to politics. We can go back into the 50s. We have newly independent states. Establishing a media system is one of the first badges of sovereignty and independence. The state was the media were the state. It started in countries like Kuwait and Lebanon and Morocco in the 50s, ending with Oman in the early 70s, where all Arab states equipped themselves with national broadcasting systems. Within 10 or 15 years, the first challenge on the horizon occurred. Those were video cassettes. So for the first time, people could watch something that the government had not approved in their houses. There was some control, there was some censorship, but nonetheless, that began to open. That's 70s and 80s. In the 1990s, we had the so-called satellite revolution, where suddenly the media that most people wanted to watch were not media that were organized, operated, owned, and controlled by the state, terrestrial broadcasting systems that had kind of very clear agendas of national development, protecting national security, of course, making the leader look as good as they can possibly look, as perfect as they can possibly be, to being challenged by broadcasters that started broadcasting out of Europe via satellite, then moved to places like Dubai and Doha, and that challenged the official state narratives. That challenged them in ways that were that did not only tell people that what states were saying was not true, but showed them also that what the states were saying in their own national media was not true. So much so that some surveys that you've never heard about, by the late 90s, some of the evening news bulletins of state broadcasters in some of the Arab states were watched by 2 or 3% of the national audience. They may as well have not existed. They are the proverbial tree in the forest. The tree falls, nobody hears it. In 2000, the decade saw the advent of the web in the Arab world. Blogging took off. By 2010, Web 2.0, social media, you know the story. And we've moved from truth being an ownership of the states through state-controlled media, one version of the truth, to having that version being challenged by, instead of a monologue, supposedly being a dialogue. Talk shows were the most popular shows in the 90s on satellite channels, to now being in an environment where we have multiple truths competing for visibility and attention. Now, what does that mean? That means a few things. Number one, it means that the environment that we deal with is an environment that is not predicated on the primacy of states. We've all heard of non-state actors. We've all heard of not only terrorist groups and shady groups that vie for power, but also a sense that if you want to understand what's going on, you can no longer afford not to attend to multiple sources of information. And that creates a lot of problems. It creates linguistic problems. It creates ideological issues, of course. And it creates an environment where those of us who follow the field, just to give you an idea, when I started doing this kind of work in the early 90s, Al Jazeera was not even there. There were a few channels that were important in their national environments. By the late 90s, we were following 20, 30 channels. Today, if you want to get an accurate representation, that's just television, you have to follow 700 channels. Of course, 20 of these really matter. But you have to follow the entire landscape in order to understand. Add this to the millions of tweets that come out in Arabic on a daily basis. You look at places like Saudi Arabia. Now the Saudi public sphere is, Twitter sphere is ablaze with opinion about every single topic you can imagine. How do you keep up with this? So the challenge that we have as academics, as analysts, as journalists, is to be able to stay on top of the whole picture. That has become, I would like to argue, nearly impossible. So we've moved from an environment where sources of information were predictable, where we had analytical prisms through which to interpret that information, to an environment where the amount of information is literally overwhelming. It's insurmountable. It's not something that any analytical mind can digest. And in that environment, as I said, we have many more actors. The cost of having a source of information at your disposal has gone from needing a building and studios and electrical power and the tanks and the soldiers around it to protect it to having electrical power and a laptop. So this is really a tremendous shift in the power to communicate. Now, so how do we begin to understand? I'd like to propose a couple of principles. One of the principles that I'd like to propose is that every actor in, let's take the Arab uprisings as an example. Every actor, every political group, every regime, every government, every embassy has a narrative to push, is a strategic player, is not... very often, for instance, coverage of some of the activists in the Arab world has taken their words for granted. Now, I work with a lot of activists and I work with a lot of academics, and they each have a story. They're all savvy communicators, and they're trying to push their view of events. And very often, their view is taken as the truth with a capital T, whoever they might be. I think that is a problem. I think we need to really go back to the old investigative comparative method where you compare multiple sources of information before reaching a point of view. The situation got to a point where, especially with the advent of social media, where we have a situation that I have called in you know, many discussions and presentations, I've called it Plato's digital cave. I don't know if you recall Plato's analogy of the cave. Plato, to talk and explain his view of how the truth is reached, talks about stages of dialogue, a fictional dialogue between two people, about the cave. And he said, look, imagine you're a prisoner. There's a group of prisoners chained to the floor inside a cave facing a wall. And behind a prisoner, there's an area where people pass. And there's a fire. And all the prisoners can see, because they are shackled, they are chained, they cannot turn around and look for themselves. They see shadows projected on the wall. Now imagine yourself to be the prisoner for a very long time. At some point, you begin to think that the shadows on the wall are the reality. You begin to think that the shadows on the wall are the truth. And I think to a large extent, media organizations whose jobs were to really investigate the truth and follow what's going on, because of a variety of commercial pressures, because of a variety of political norms, because of a variety of huge investments in geopolitical battles, have really abandoned, relinquished that role to focus on excavating what exactly happens in any given time. So that we've had many false stories. We've had stories about a woman in Homs who got tortured and killed by the Syrian regime, who then showed up a few days later on television. We have stories of fake Twitter accounts who speak in the names of people who a few days later say, wait a second, This is not my account. I didn't say this. We have false witnesses. We have fabricated videos. So what I'd like to do, you know, as an academic who can afford to be critical, to be an equal opportunity critic, what I'd like to do is to propose to you to be fundamentally the first response to anything I see coming out of this highly politicized, very volatile field of representation that comes out from areas where people are dying on a daily basis. Once we reduce these the revolutions, the struggles that are going on the ground in blood, in sacrifice that really most of us cannot begin to understand, once we reduce these to cliches and pictures and words and headlines, we really lose sight of what's truly is going on. And so what I'd like to propose to you, therefore, is to be always, to be, in a sense, what Plato's role, the role that Plato ascribes to the philosopher, to be the people who can be critical and can take a distance from these narratives and say, yes, over time, this seems to be what is really going on. Over time, this seems to be what happened in that event. But I think on a day-to-day basis, if you follow the news today, what you see is strategic narratives being shaped by events, but also being shaped by the actors who put them out, that then, instead of being open to an incident or an event on the ground challenging that narrative, what they actually do is try to fit any event, any incident on the ground within the norms of the narratives that they favor. I hope we can discuss this further. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thanks very much, Marwan, for your presentation. Now we move to our second speaker, Wadah Khanfar. I had to practice on that. Actually, my Arabic teacher gave me some tips, but not sure if I did pronounce it properly. Need some more lessons, I'm sure. Now, he is in high demand as a speaker throughout the world. Actually, in 2011, Foreign Policy magazine put him number one on the list of 100 global thinkers. He is a co-founder of the Al-Shaq Foundation, which is an independent network promoting dialogue in the Middle East and North Africa, and also tries to design or at least promote long-term strategies for political development, social justice, and economic development. Now, he has been with Al Jazeera for quite a long time, since the beginning, and in between 2003 until 2011, he was the Director General of Al Jazeera, basically the boss, the person in charge of Al Jazeera. Before that, he was working for Al Jazeera in South Africa, Afghanistan, Iraq. He was bureau chief there and covered the wars in those countries, not in South Africa, of course, but Afghanistan and Iraq. And during his tenure as the leader, as a director general of Al Jazeera, this network grew from one single television channel to a system, a network with multiple channels, catering to many different audiences. So it really became a player to be taken seriously in not only in the region, in the Middle East and North Africa, but throughout the world, people looking for information on things happening in the Arab world and beyond, actually. Also in Africa, they're quite strong. Now, interestingly, there is a little bit of a link between Professor Kraidy and Mr. Khanfar, which is that Mr. Kraidy mentioned also, of course, Al Jazeera elaborately, but I believe also he mentioned Wadah Khanfar in his book in, I think, not a negative and positive way, but quite factual. So I have the page for you somewhere, but I'll try to find it. Now, well, without any further ado, because I'm sure you're all familiar with the CV and all the achievements of Mr. Khanfar, we're very proud that he's here tonight. I mean, he flew in from Abu Dhabi, is then going back to Turkey, South America, I don't know, everywhere. I hope you know where you are. You're in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam, here in the Rode Hoed, and we're very happy to have you here. Now, please welcome him with a warm round of applause. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you very much for attending this meeting. And I have just left Al Jazeera 2 years ago, after 8 years of running the network. And during the last 2 years, I was actually always contemplating the experience. I do still regard myself as a journalist in heart, although definitely I'm involved in many other projects right now. But I felt that journalism is not a profession that you take in order to secure and put bread on the table. Journalism is a spirit that resides in you. Some of our pessimist journalists, they call it virus, that goes in and doesn't go out. But journalism is a spirit. You should look at it as a spirit if you would really like to be committed to the cause of journalism. And those journalists who always consult me when they are at the beginning of their career and ask me what could be the best advice for us to further our career, I will tell them, if you are in this profession for the sake of fame, the sake of money, or the sake of power, quit. This is not your game. You will betray the cause. Journalism is a cause and should be seen as a cause. And when I covered for Al Jazeera and my colleagues all over the world events, and we were witnesses of calamities, of disasters, of massacres, of killing, of sectarian confrontations, of famines, always it came to our mind that we are here in order to entrench our capabilities and our power amongst the people. We are representing those at the margin, in front of those at the center. Because unfortunately, our world of today is biased against those in the margin by those in the center. And journalism for a while, and still actually, is becoming part of the center. Centers of power, politics, and money. This is what most of our corporations are all about. This is what all CEOs and director generals and chairmen of organizations are concerned about most of the time. Are they gaining or they are losing? Are their bank accounts growing or they are decreasing? This cause of journalism, unfortunately, has become a commodity for business people to invest in and for politicians to utilize. That is not the form of journalism that I have seen colleagues of mine dying in the fields of Iraq and Afghanistan and in Libya to achieve. None of them was paid money to sacrifice his life. They did sacrifice because they thought that they are living for a cause. They are projecting the suffering of the public and the public interest for the world. They are challenging the status quo that is imbalanced and that is marginalizing the masses of today for the sake of the centers of powers of today. The second important element which I witnessed during the last 2 years, why I feel I am attached to this profession, why I feel I am part of it and I will continue to be part of it, and I wish that I will die one day and still I am a journalist. One thing. When we speak about truth, and this gentleman here sitting and trying to eat or to be fed from the screen in front of him, we are entrusted in people's mind and people's choices and people's life. News, especially in the Arab world where I have come from, is a matter of life and death. It's not just a complementary knowledge about reality. If you misfeed people with the wrong information and the wrong knowledge, you may lead to the death of people. You may lead to the rise of violence, of sectarianism, of extremism, and of people who think that they could kill for the sake of their cause. This is why the heavy responsibility of putting something in front of the public is really a top priority in the mind and the heart of the true journalist. He feels the responsibility towards the truth, not because he would like to gain credibility from the public, not because he would like to get rating from the public, not because he would like to be celebrated as a fantastic journalist, because he has something in his heart that tells him
be careful. Your word could kill or could be a reason for someone to kill. Be careful. Feed people, not with information and data, but with knowledge, with tools of analysis, with context for the news. Don't give them something to consume if that something could kill them. That could be poisonous. Always, always, you must wrap it with the context of it. Don't, for the sake of breaking news and being the first in the world to break the story, sacrifice on the authenticity and the integrity of the reporting. You have a responsibility not only to gain the rating, but also to gain the mission of those who are your reporting to. Security, safety of them, peace, and to gain for them as well proper knowledge about reality so they could judge for their choices much better than before. That is a responsibility. So it is a cause and it is a responsibility. Within these parameters, we need to operate. If someone would love to see journalism something else, he's most welcome to do it. But I can tell you, this is not the thing that I have subscribed to. This is not what my colleagues, when we were working in Al Jazeera, subscribed to. This is not what I do believe journalism should be.
I think we're still here on the stage. You get a chance later to ask a question or make a
the
remark.
The second point.
Please, hello. Where is that coming from, that sound? We just wait.
Okay.
Wait for your turn.
The second point, which I would like here to mention,
just carry on.
Also about this issue of profession that I've subscribed to and I love and still wish that I will continue to be described as a journalist, is the issue of whether we are, at the head of these organizations, always are capable of implementing this ideal through the practicality of our networks. Our profession has been invaded recently with something called technology, but not the ordinary technology that we were used to in the 90s, but it is the social networking that have brought to us great opportunities, but brought to us great challenge. And if you are attending a conference of today for executives of networks, which I sometimes call to attend, you find that the people in this industry are panicking because the foundations of the model, the economic model, the commercial model that was built has been disturbed. Why? Because there is a shift in the profession. There is a structural shift from the pyramid-like organization that all of us are used to run for the last few decades since the beginning of journalism and the news, up to the network, the wall that is flat, the wall that is diverse, the wall that is full of opinions. The world is rife of those who are capable of giving their opinion and they have the courage to come forward to say and to tell their story. Our monopoly on the news has been broken. And we have, and we are right now, facing a new reality. Some of us would love to dismiss all of that and say, this is nonsense, not authentic, not fantastic, no credibility, no double sourcing. Let us move on. We are the journalists. We graduated from school of journalism. We have been running it. We have the experience. We are the producers and the editors of the news. And some of us would say, you know, let us find a model where we could embrace the future. This is a trend that has arrived not to disappear. It is going to be with us, and most likely it's going to replace even us, unless if we find a way of enriching our paradigm, our model with this newcomer. Networks have provided us with two important elements. The first one, interactivity. Now, from now on, our audience are not those who are going only to receive the food from our hand. They are those who are going also to give the feedback immediately. They are going to protest their point of view. They are going to participate. They're going to illuminate. They are going to interpret. They are going to give the opinion. They are going to be involved. Interactivity. We are not used to these naughty audience who are trying always to give their opinion and to challenge the wisdom of the fancy and magnificent editors who have been groomed to tell the universe the truth and the absolute truth and nothing but the truth. The second, which networks have provided to us, it challenged the very structure of our corporations. Director general, managing editor, head of news, manager, head of section, employee. This is 6, 7, 8 levels of employment in our structures. But in the new case, a flat structure with catalysts that you follow voluntarily. You receive the information, you retweet their opinion. There is no responsibility and there is no hierarchy. Cheap to maintain, easy to work on, and it might replace the most expensive structure that news corporations have. Now, because we are losing money because of the international crisis, what we are doing right now, instead of us revisiting our structure and embracing this magnificent model of networking, we are cutting on the budget that goes to the news. I don't have to send the crew to Afghanistan to spend 2 weeks in order to make a beautiful feature story. Let them spend 3 days. I cut on the budget. But in 3 days, these guys, the poor guys who are going there, they will know nothing about Afghanistan. And when they put their piece on the news, they are giving superficiality. They are feeding people of nothing but fragmented, puzzled notion about something called Afghanistan, but not deep, proper understanding. Investigative journalism, whereby I spent 6 months to do a documentary to investigate a case, has been sacrificed for the sake of journalism, of immediacy. I rather stream live an event happening somewhere, free of charge, cheap, and nowadays with Skype, almost nothing. Instead of me sending a crew to investigate a crime or a corruption or something that's happening in part of the world. Very expensive, keep it aside. Instead of me introducing the concept of field journalism and permanent correspondence in various parts of the world to reflect the diversity of the world, we start just going to Reuters, Associated Press, France Press, copy and paste on our screens. We have sacrificed depth for the sake of superficiality. And we have sacrificed mature journalism for the sake of immediacy. And we embedded ourselves in this issue of cutting budget, while the executives and the leaders are still there. So when we cut the budget, we cut it on those who are operating the core business, and we keep it for those who are operating the corporate and marketing and fancy and beautiful offices that we have. That is a major challenge in this profession. Unless we restructure ourselves and embrace this philosophy of networking and cut the bureaucracy and be faithful to the core business of journalism, I think corporations of media and journalism might collapse in the next 2 to 5 years and we will find ourselves out of job. Now, but networks lack two important elements that we, the so-called professional journalists, could provide. The first one is the context. In the 120 character of Twitter, you can't really put a lot of context, can you? In most of our Facebook posts, there is nothing of context, most of the time impressions, opinions. So the context of events sometimes is not there. The accuracy is not there. Sometimes the rumors spread virally to an extent that it becomes like a conventional wisdom while it is not founded in reality. Because until now, the techniques we, the organizations who regard ourselves as the mainstream, have not developed yet proper techniques of utilizing this kind of income, which we call social networking, and try to filter it and project it and use it in a professional manner, unfortunately. But there is a second element which networks as well lack, prioritization. Most of the news are not necessarily structured on a priority. So when you receive something over the posts, you find that the people sometimes are trending with an incident or an issue that's not necessarily of common interest. It might not be of a value for the future and the knowledge of the society. And therefore, still professional journalism is necessary to continue, but to be reformed in order to be capable of living and surviving. Professional journalism is a necessity to have this kind of intermarriage with social networks and to introduce a new model, not just to have a website for your TV station or a Twitter account for your newspaper, but to have a new model built from zero based on this intermarriage and integration, complete integration between professional journalism and social networks. That is the solution. I don't see much in that regard yet, because we are still entrenching ourselves in our trenches, defending this newcomer, hoping that a day will come when we will be left alone. That is not going to happen. I would like to conclude by saying, when I was in Al Jazeera, and I was telling always my colleagues, we may not be able to tell the truth, all of it, but we shall never tell the falsehood. You cannot always tell the truth, practically. I wish if you were living in a peaceful, democratic, transparent, and a stable society that everything could be reported in a fantastic way. But when you are threatened that a correspondent will be put in jail or killed because you will broadcast a news item that you have knowledge of, believe me, as a director general, that will be a tough decision to make. It will be a very tough decision to make. I still remember that the worst moment in my life when I had to drive my car to the family of a cameraman of Al Jazeera who was killed in Libya, and I have to drive my car to knock on the door and to speak to the wife and the children about the death of their father. That was a very difficult choice to make. So our road was not rosy. It needed a lot of courage, but a lot of wisdom. It needed a lot of patience, but it needed also not to be emotional. It needs to detach yourself from the story when the story itself does not detach itself from you. It was really the most difficult 8 years that I've spent in my life, because day and night you feel you are under that consistent heavy pressure of the responsibility and consistent heavy pressure of the fact that you have people you need to protect in the field, and you have people you have to protect by introducing good knowledge to them. That was not a good combination to have in something called the Arab world, where the word could kill, and the statement could lead you to jail, and the integral reporting could actually create a crisis between countries and the states. That was true. But again and again I say, the issue we are confronted with as leaders of newsrooms and leaders of organizations, if it is always weighed by the public interest and the responsibility, we will be safe. But if it is weighed by the personal interest or commercial interest or state interest, we are going to betray the people. We are going to betray the profession. And we should be aware of that. Yes, we did take decisions in many cases not to be professional in a moment of time, because we wanted to protect certain kind of people. We wanted to protect our crews. We wanted to protect our beers. We wanted to do a lot of things. But we never took a decision to mislead the public or to misguide them or to misinform them, because in my opinion, that is worse than killing. Because really, you are assassinating people's minds and you might lead them lead them astray. The final word for anyone who would like to pick up this profession or would like to deal with it: be equipped with knowledge. A journalist who is operating as a journalist because only he graduated from the School of Journalism might not be a journalist who will really do something solid for his society. Always I tell our guys in the newsroom, convert this newsroom into a study center. You should have the knowledge of history. You should have the patience and the mercy in your hearts to be good journalists. Not enough to pick up the information and frame it and put it in the screen. It is something that goes into your heart, and after that from your tongue and your hand. Don't betray your tongue and your hand and the public by allowing others to dictate upon you what should be done for their interest. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Khanfar. We could see from responses from the floor and some from the balcony, I forgot, that at least it's a topic that has great interest among the audience. And we'll see during the Q&A how that sort of will play out. Now we have to see, we have to have a connection
Yes, we do have a connection, and I'm very happy with that. We see Sander van Hoorn, who is our NOS Dutch television correspondent in Beirut, covering the Arab world. Welcome, Sander. Can you hear us?
I can hear you fine. Thank you.
Okay, great. Now, next to Sander, you see ANA, because that's actually Rami Jarrah, a Syrian journalist and activist from the border with Syria. Unfortunately, there's no image, but I hope there is some sound. His yes. Pseudonym is Alexander Page. So, Alexander, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you clearly. Thank you, and good evening to everyone. Unfortunately, I can't see any of you as well.
Yeah. Would you like me to address you as Alexander or Rami?
No, Rami is fine. Thank you.
Rami is fine. Okay. Now, I would like to put forward a few questions to you. Now, maybe first to Sander, a question. We've been debating here, and of course also in the media, but both speakers have addressed the integrity of the media, objectivity, independence of the media, as far as that is possible to reach. Now, could you tell us something about what sources do you trust to receive news from? How do you work?
Well, it's difficult because it's a big region, and because of cost cuts we had at NOS, basically I'm a one-man shop. So you have to be very selective, and it's basically a matter of journalistic rules. So no matter what kind of source you have, whether it's through Twitter, face-to-face, on the phone, Skype, you have to weigh your sources, and you always have to remind yourself that one source is no source. And another thing, of course, is that every source has an agenda. And those are basic journalistic rules that apply to any form of contact you have. And I think here in Lebanon, that's quite clear, because here the agendas are very much open and on the table. Everybody has one. And that's also with Twitter. I mean, it's a very useful source of information. It gives me a heads up. But as has been said before by, I think, both of my predecessors, that Twitter is also very much about hypes. It's about very brief information. It's about not giving context. So you have to take that in mind. But that's basically the job of a journalist.
Yeah, but you said, I mean, you feel that the sources or the people you talk to, I mean, they all have their political agenda, and it's very obvious what agenda they have. But how do you then weigh the news? Do you bring both views then forward, or do you choose?
No, if there's more than one side to a story, of course you cover both. It doesn't have to be necessarily in one story. And one of the biggest examples is our coverage of Syria. If we cover it through agencies, and I contribute through my contacts, then you can have both sides of the story in one story. But for example, I am being granted a visa to Damascus. So while I'm there, I'm covering only one side of the story, which is not bad, because we have other teams going into through the north of Syria, through Turkey to Aleppo to Idlib. So they cover the other side of the story. So it doesn't have to necessarily be within
Well, sorry, Sander, the sound, we can't hear you at the moment. Neither
somebody
can you.
Claim.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, if you hear somebody claim something, that you provide the context that there is another side to the story.
Okay, thanks very much. Now we see if Rami is still with us. Rami, are you still with us?
Yes, yes, I am.
Okay, you are. I mean, you're also very close to Syria, just as Sander is. You're in southern Turkey, I understand.
Yes.
We won't exactly tell where you are. I'm not sure if you want that to be disclosed.
No, it's fine. I'm currently in Gaziantep.
Okay. Now, could you tell us something about the role of citizen journalists? How would you compare that role to the large media networks? Is there any difference in the way they work?
Yes, I would definitely say there was a lot of difference. Lots of the information that was being derived from Syria was dependent on citizen journalism. I can say that even the citizen journalists that we were talking to on the ground in certain areas across Syria when we'd left Syria, we also held an agenda, as do they hold an agenda. And this is the problem. This is why I think they're citizen journalists and we can't consider just straightforward journalists. the information that was being derived was dependent on from major news networks such as Al Jazeera and Al Arabiya, and of course all the international media. It was just the sheer fact that people knew this that made the possibility.
No, that connection is gone, but we just continue with Sander. Can you hear us still, Sander, in Beirut? No, then we go maybe back to our panelists here in the audience. Would you like to respond to this, Wadah?
You know, as I said, you know, social networks, as I said, is a great opportunity. But most of the time, they are carrying certain kind of perspective. It is necessary to listen to the perspective of the public, but that cannot replace the concept of journalism narrated by those who understand the foundations and the guidelines of the profession itself. So what I would like to say in the case of Syria in particular, where unfortunately most of the coverage of our networks, including Al Jazeera, Al Arabiya, and many other international networks, were banned from going into Syria, and we had to cover the story dependent on social networks. And actually, that means, in principle, that you are not balanced, because you will go into that camp, you will narrate the story, but you have no access to the ground on the other side. It is not balanced not because of your choice, because of the regime, you know, choice itself that has banned you. But always I tell the guys also that is not the end of the story, because you should substitute your absence by proper common sense, analytical framework that provides knowledge, and don't fall in the trap of you becoming an activist yourself defending a cause rather than narrating a story and weighing the alternatives and introducing the opinions.
How difficult is it as a journalist when you are working in such a difficult environment and with an oppressive regime not to become an activist?
It is unfortunately becoming much more than difficult than ever. Much more difficult than ever. I have never seen the Arab world so polarized as today. Before, we used to afford to distance ourselves from the story, to report even during the war in Iraq and the war in Afghanistan, although there was a huge amount of emotionality in the region and the frustration and reaction against the American occupation of Iraq and Afghanistan. But we were able as journalists to at least have access to both sides and narrate the story. Now, unfortunately, you have access most of the time to one part of the story. And the polarization, the sectarian polarization, the ideological polarization is so huge to an extent that it will eventually go through the lenses of the journalist himself. And it is difficult to stop the biases of journalists. The last 2 years, in my opinion, are the worst for the profession in the Arab world. If you watch what the Egyptian media is all about today, or the Tunisian media is all about today, or most of the Arab media is all about today, you feel that we have sacrificed a lot on professional side for the sake of activism, on the integrity of reporting for the sake of enthusiasm. And that is not actually a very healthy environment. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I think we have Sander van Hoorn back. Well, technical people, just put him on the screen if he's here. Otherwise, we'll just continue. Okay, no, welcome back, Sander.
Yeah. Hi there.
Okay, so we had some discussion here. Also on the role of citizen journalists, whether it's difficult at some point, if that was a question which Wadah Khanfar also answered, if you are really involved in the topic and you see that horrible acts are being committed at citizens, it must be very difficult not to choose sides and not to become an activist. What is your response for that, of course?
Well, there's different approaches to this subject. First of all, I'm an outsider. So on an institutional level, it's very easy for me to say, okay, this is your fight, I'm not taking sides. But then you see suffering, and then it's actually very gratifying that you have an important task to show the suffering of people, whether it be Syrians, refugees, people living inside Syria, Egyptians, Palestinians, I don't care. But to show the suffering to the world might help to solve it. And that's, I think, an important contribution you can take, and that's a form of activism. But I would never let it go so far that my reporting could be considered activist. And one of the things I do to deal with that challenge, because it is a challenge, because you do see suffering and injustice, is to be aware of the injustice and how it affects you. Because being aware of how it affects you is the first step towards keeping it out of your reporting, or at least framing it in a way that you cannot present it as a fact, but keep it like as objective as possible. But it's a constant challenge, especially in this region. If you are on a square where people are very jubilant, it's hard not to be with those people. If they are being shot at, it's hard not to be with those people. So yeah, it's a challenge.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much. Marwan, would you like to respond to this?
I was very pleased to hear that Sander got a visa to go to Syria, because I think it's emblematic of the way the conflict is covered, that our two local speakers are one in Turkey, one in Lebanon. A journalist, by definition, is a witness.
Yep.
A journalist is a witness that mediates between reality and the public. And the way this conflict, in particular, is being covered is we have, between the public and reality, we have, in the best cases, three or four mediators. And we know what happens when you convey information from one source to the other. We've all played that game. What you get at the end is not what you would get if you had a reduced number of filters. So when we see stories about that go from a Skype conversation with somebody who was with somebody on the ground who tells us a story, we hear that, we weigh it, other sources, we tell the story already, you have three or four or five filters. And I think that's the problem, and that's exactly what I'm trying to say. The more filters you have, the more there are opportunities for narratives that are intentional to seep into the story.
Mm-hmm. Sander, if I correct, but please correct me if I'm wrong, you are one of the few journalists who is allowed to enter Syria. I mean, through to go to Damascus from the Netherlands or.
Yeah, I mean, there are actually quite a few, also international networks. Sky News gets regular visa, the German ARD, Channel 4, CBC, but it's not enough. And they are very selective. And it has a downside, being granted visas, because when I was to meet Alexander and join him into the northern part of Syria, then I would never get a visa again. So there is a downside, and that's why it's very important that we send crews to both sides of the conflict, to both parts of Syria. But yes, I get visa, and sometimes that's actually important, because I was there last summer when there was this attack in Damascus on a number of ministers, and I was virtually the only journalist at that time. So it's very important that we still go and we make sure that at any given moment there is somebody relatively objective to report of what can be told from there.
And do you feel that there is some pressure, or is it very difficult to bring forward, let's say, if you hear something in Damascus from the government side, is that difficult to bring that, to present that? Is there some pressure to not to do it or to give it a twist? Because I mean,
well, I like yeah. Pressure. I like propaganda. I love it. I mean, no. When I was reporting from Israel Palestine, you had something called the Israel Project. I love them because their spin was so over the top. I always called it the porn of propaganda. And it made you aware of the more subtle spin you received afterwards. So I like government spokespeople to very openly try to influence them, because that makes it easier for me to choose my own path. And that's very much preferable over like subtle influence. But no, I'm always surprised that in Damascus, of course, I cannot go everywhere. Of course, I have to be aware that if I try to do reach the contacts within the opposition I do have, that I don't endanger myself. The worst thing that can happen to me is that I'm being imprisoned or being sent out of the country, but I might threaten their lives. So that's something I'm very much aware of. But so you cannot go everywhere, but the amount of direct influence I get when I'm there is actually quite limited.
Now, you just mentioned you like the pressure of governments and propaganda and so, because then you can give your views. Now, maybe a cheeky question, but how do you ensure you don't get influenced by the Dutch foreign ministry, for example?
Well, they never offered me money. That's quite a bit.
They never offered you money. No, that's clear. I can guarantee that. We don't spend your taxpayers' money on that.
Yeah, exactly. No, other than my contacts with you, I don't have a lot of contacts with the foreign ministry. I do, of course, with the diplomats, for example, here in Lebanon or in Egypt. And they are not, as far as I'm aware, trying to influence me. They're more interested in the stories I have because I do speak to Hezbollah, I do speak to Hamas, I do speak to the Syrian government, and that's something diplomats can only dream of. So actually, I'm quite a source of information for them, I guess. But the influence might come from my news desk, but that's also quite disappointing. I mean, I'm very... alone in the way I make decisions about what is news and what is not news. Sometimes I'm being called by the news desk.
So you have a lot of freedom, actually.
Yeah, I do
have
a lot of
freedom. Decide which topics you choose.
And I think that it is in part one of my major objectives here, not to be on camera on the 8 o'clock news. I mean, that's part of it, but a big part of it is to talk to people, to read people, to look around you in the country where you are, to provide context. And a big part of the context I provide to NOS, for example, is they call me and they ask, this is happening. And I'm like, okay, it's not really important because it happened yesterday also. That it wasn't on the wires is not my fault, but it did happen. Very good example here in Lebanon, for example. For over 2 years, NOS has been calling me asking, so when is the war in Syria going to spill over? Because BBC, Al Jazeera, CNN, they keep on reporting it. And I'm like, it's not. Oh, it has spilled over, but not to the extent that people are fighting each other in the streets. And I can give them the context as to why it hasn't happened yet. And that's a big part of my job, like giving context, also keeping stories out of the news or giving it the right perspective. That's well, I think a big thing of what I do here.
Thanks very much. Now, I would like to pick up on one of the points you mentioned just before we open the floor to questions and answers. I'm sure there are a lot of them. We go to Mr. Khanfar. I just want to pick up on the point which you mentioned that you're quite independent in the selection of the news items you present and maybe even the way you present it, of course, according to the high standards that the NOS has set. Wadah, Khanfar, is that the same for Al Jazeera? Are the reporters or the bureau chiefs in the different countries, are they quite independent in the items they choose, or do they get more instructions or guidance from headquarters?
No, when I was a reporter myself, when I was bureau chief of Al Jazeera in Baghdad and in Afghanistan, before that in Africa, I don't remember at all that the news desk will phone me in order to alter a story that I have written or I have prepared, produced for the screen. That has never happened in my career. And that is a tradition that I felt it should continue in Al Jazeera when I became the head of Al Jazeera, because nothing much more important than giving confidence to a reporter who is struggling and striving on the field in order to really professionally does his job. Now, there are circumstances in two cases. The first one, if there is a factual mistake or there is imbalance in the story. So you will demand that the story should be balanced and it should be rectified or double sourced or anything related to the guidelines of the profession itself. In the other case, in certain severe circumstances, if you feel that a news report has arrived to, and that could happen once in 1,000 times, that might, in a way or another, endanger another crew somewhere else working for you in that country, you may delay it or you may keep it aside or you try to deal with it in a manner that doesn't endanger the life of your other staff that is working somewhere else. Besides that, the news desk has no right to frame or interview or to spin the story that a correspondent is preparing.
Yeah, thanks very much. So a large degree of decentralization. And okay, we now go to the basically to the audience. First, I see hands going up, and I will definitely give you an opportunity, at least try. But first, we need the microphones. So please raise your hand and don't speak without having the microphone. I will decide who gets the microphone. It's extremely arbitrary, I do realize it, but it will sort of go through the crowds a little bit. This lady was really first. And please give us your name, maybe affiliation. If you could stand up, please, and say who you addressed the question to. Yeah, you like to say it? Okay. Short questions, no statements.
Tahrid al Khodari, Palestinian journalist. My question to Mr. Wadah. Al Jazeera, when it started, it was a real, like, a dream. All fabric of society was glued to the screen. And for them, it was, you know, the dream has become true. And then, you know, with the events, you know, for example...
Can you speak in the microphone?
Yeah. With the events, when, for example, the conflict between Fatah and Hamas in the Palestinian territories took place, then people, you know, like all of a sudden, they became divided, the Palestinians. So those who are in support of Fatah chose to go to Al Arabiya TV, and those who are in support of Hamas went to Al Jazeera. So that was the sad...
Sorry, short questions. Lots of people want to
that was
ask
the me. Sad thing. So is there now a new strategy? Because Al Jazeera, my point here, Al Jazeera has lost many audience, and is there a new strategy to get back that audience? And also, why Al Jazeera America? Al Jazeera English has...
Okay, the question is clear.
I have to move on. Successful please. Story. Yeah. You know, it's
okay.
Really
the question is there a new strategy? Why Al Jazeera America? We get a... Of course, but who's next? I saw a hand, the lady there. Yeah.
Good evening. I am Hanan Shamoun, Syrian Dutch. First of all, I would like to thank...
Sorry, can the sound be a little bit louder through the speakers? Gentlemen of the technic... Okay, go ahead.
First of all, I would like to thank Mr. Kraidy for his serious and objective summary about the Arab media. And I'd like to hear from him, if you please, Mr. Kraidy, about how far is Al Jazeera involved and in the bloodshed in Syria and other Arabic worlds. Especially with forcing for the name Arabic Spring. It is an
okay, thanks very
Islamic
much
spring.
For your question.
No, another one?
No, sorry, now you get one question. We have to move on now.
Only one for Mr.
No, sorry.
Wadah.
We move to the next one. We get a third question here, the gentleman over here. I have to be very strict, otherwise people get frustrated. They can't ask a question.
Hussein Sabir, Dutch journalist for Wadah Khanfar. I'm... wondering if you can tell us something about choices he made. For example, in the Arab Spring, you covered the Libyan revolt, but you didn't cover the problems in Bahrain.
Okay, we have three questions. Do we have someone who has a question for Sander there on the screen, who especially came, well, via Skype from Beirut? Do you have a question for Sander van Hoorn? Okay.
Yes, I do.
Okay, go ahead.
My name is Mara Winke. I'm actually a Dutch journalism student. And I was wondering, Sander, do you think it is possible to stay objective when you're there on your own and you can't really have like a dialogue with your partners or other fellow Dutch journalists?
Okay, thanks very much. Then we have a number of questions, I think, for we get another round for Wadah Khanfar.
You know, looking back at what has happened during the last few years in Al Jazeera, you know, of course, the phase that you are talking about, which is from 2006 up to today, the Arab world has gone through unbelievable polarization because the fight in Sudan, in Darfur, between the North and the South, in Somalia, between Hamas and Fatah, and then between the Shia and Sunni in Iraq, and the issue of the Western Sahara in Morocco. All of that has happened in the Arab world. Conflict, sectarian, religious, and ethnic conflicts within the Arab world. In general, we have been criticized by everyone, in a way. We have been criticized because a lot of people thought that they have the cause, especially when it is based on sectarian or religious or ideological foundations. Their cause is the winner, and you should take a stance supporting the cause. If you don't do it, then you are siding with the other. And we were criticized by all sides. In the morning, Al-Qaeda will issue a statement criticizing us. In the evening, Rumsfeld will come on air and criticize us. Some days, Hamas will be upset with our coverage in Gaza and they threaten to arrest the correspondents, and then Fatah will close down the bureau in Ramallah. In Morocco, they will kick us out because of the Western Sahara, and Al-Bulisari will issue a statement saying that we are biased. It was the most terrible moment. Why? Because the Arab world itself became polarized and divided. Now, it is a tough choice to really do that. And this is what we were trying to explain to the people. We are not here to embrace your point of view. We are here to report on it. You have the right to have your voice through our screen, but you don't have the right that we defend your point of view. And that was actually impossible to explain to most of the factions up to date, which I am not now part of Al Jazeera. 2 years ago, I left Al Jazeera, and I don't speak on behalf of Al Jazeera, but I follow the news as I used to follow then. And I see today what's happening in Egypt and the amount of polarization against Al Jazeera by the state itself because of what has happened. The issue about the Al-Bahrain. America, of course, Al Jazeera America is a channel that has been launched about 3 months ago. It is too early to judge it. It is a channel where it is addressing the American audience called Al Jazeera America, broadcasting from various locations, especially from San Francisco and from New York. It could be a promising project for the American audience if it actually sticks to the ideas of Al Jazeera. The courage, question the authorities, give fresh perspective on the news. But if it becomes another platform of delivering news like other networks in America, I don't think it will succeed. So the issue is, will Al Jazeera have a clear, definite identity in America, or it's going to be just another American channel? Now, about Bahrain's story. When Bahrain was taking place, and by the way, we did not cover Bahrain, this is not true. Our bureau in Bahrain was shut down, our correspondents were kicked out, and our banned from traveling to Bahrain. We had to send undercover reporters into Bahrain to report the stories secretly from there. And when they came back, they did excellent documentary, first-class international documentary about the atrocities committed by the government of Bahrain against the opposition. But the revolution in Bahrain took place, or the uprising took place, when Egypt was on fire. When Libya was still, there is international fight taking place in Libya. When Syria, the revolution has already started. When Yemen was already taking place, when Darfur was still fighting. When you are ahead of news and you sit by the end of the day in front of your desk and look at all the stories and you would like to prioritize, you would put Egypt number one, definitely, because it has a heavy weight and a lot of interest in the audience will be to follow what's happening in Egypt. From a geopolitical perspective, it is the most important story. Then you might have Libya. There is an international fighting taking place in Libya. Then you will have Syria. Bahrain will be covered, but it might not be on the top of priority. So it is not fair to demand from me, since I would like to prove a point about Bahrain, I need to deal with Bahrain as I do deal with Egypt. Because everyone in the region and internationally knows that the weight of Bahrain, from a political point of view and from editorial point of view, is not actually as equal as the weight of other stories. So it is an editorial judgment. It is not an editorial bias, the issue of Bahrain.
Thanks very much. Then we go to Sander van Hoorn. Could you hear the question? Was addressed to you by a
student. No, yeah, I could hear it perfectly fine. And to follow up on the previous question, I mean, Al Jazeera does cover Bahrain, but indeed, maybe not send a whole team. Maybe that's not possible. But if they show images, however briefly, then they do cover it. And it's something about objectivity. The question was, is it possible to remain objective? The clear and simple answer is no, of course not. I'm human, and wherever I am, whomever I talk to, it influences me. And as I said before, being aware of that is your first line, and maybe your only line of defense of trying to keep that out of your reporting. But there's a very funny thing with objectivity that one of my colleagues has said, he retired by now, but people are subjective, and that's part of the reason they think you are subjective. And that goes for my reporting. I mean, when covering the bombing of the Iranian embassy here in Beirut, I had the guts to name the word Israel. Well, that is a trigger for people from Holland to react big time, because everybody has an opinion about Israel, and that triggers a reaction. They don't listen to what you say or what you do. They just vent their opinion based on what they think you have said. And I think especially for Al Jazeera English, that's also the case in a lot of instances, that people don't actually listen or see everything Al Jazeera does, but they do have an opinion, and especially on Twitter, that's all that matters. Now, coming back to your question, objectivity is something I strive for, however difficult, but objectivity is always also something which is in the eye of the beholder, and that's you, the public.
Thanks very much for your honest answer. We go now to the other side of the audience, also in sort of a random way. Do I see any hands? Who would like to ask a question? The gentleman over there.
My name is Jan van Bentem, Nederlands Dagblad. I used to work for television, especially also in conflicts in Afghanistan, but also in the Bosnia and Kosovo region. In that time, international journalists tended to establish a kind of journalistic home from where they worked together, shared material, etc. And my question to Sander is this kind of cooperation still there? So to warn each other that certain roads are dangerous, to keep telephonic contact by telephones, where you are, when you're expected to arrive, and these kind of things, because that broadens your possibilities, okay, and also it broadens your vision.
Yeah, thanks very much. So sort of question of solidarity and helping your fellow journalists. We move on. Do we see any other hands raising? By the way, if your question has not been answered or not satisfactorily, you can afterwards go to the speakers. Unfortunately, if you are not happy with what Sander said, you have to go to Beirut, but that's up to you. Now I started this, but we're not going to that block, we're going there. Did I see a hand there, way in the back? Yeah.
Hello, I'm Hype de Zeel, a journalist. I'd like to address a question to Mr. Khanfar about the difference between Al Jazeera English and Al Jazeera Arabic. I'd like that you elaborate a little bit more about the relation between the government of Qatar and Al Jazeera Arabic, but because it seems to me that Al Jazeera English is much more independent of the government of Qatar, contrary to Al Jazeera Arabic, particularly if you look to the events in Egypt, how they portray the Brotherhood.
Thanks very much. Your question is very clear. Let's hope it can be answered in a short answer. We have a lady here at the front. Sorry, Jessica, I have to challenge your fitness, which is really up to par.
Hi, I'm a journalism student, and Mr. Khanfar, you told us that when young journalists ask you for advice, you say, if you're in it for the money, if you're in it for the fame, leave. But I'm not in it for the fame, I'm not in it for the money. What would you advise me?
Okay, well, maybe change your studies, I'm not sure. But maybe Marwan could shed your light on this last question.
I do stick to my opinion that a journalist is primarily a witness. Now, we don't live in a vacuum, we don't work in a vacuum. And I maintain every single Arab news outlet had a narrative they were pushing. I would even say every single media outlet that I've attended, that I've watched, that I've read, I typically follow Arabic, English, and French language media. They had a narrative, so let's not play games and say, no, there is something called objectivity. Everybody has all kinds of pressures they're dealing with. They can be political, they can be economic, they can be professional, they can be personal. Everybody has triggers. We've heard many questions about this. I do think Al Jazeera covered Bahrain. Did it cover Bahrain like it covered Egypt? No, it didn't. Is Egypt, in the big scheme of things, a more important story editorially? Yes. Did Al Jazeera give, even when you take editorial importance, political news importance into account, did Al Jazeera cover Bahrain as it should have? No. Why? Because Bahrain is located very close to the sponsors of Al Jazeera. If Bahrain were located next to Morocco, it would have been a different story. So let's cut to the chase and say that we all deal with pressures in how we cover events and how we make sense of them. So all you can say as a journalist is to find a news institution where you make sure that the pressure that you're dealing with are as minimal as possible. I'm very realistic, and I'm very lucky and fortunate not to be a journalist.
Thanks very much, Marwan. In some of your answers, you almost sound like a diplomat, but anyway. And that's a compliment, of course.
Of course.
Then we move on to Khanfar.
Some of my best friends are diplomats.
Al Jazeera English is different from Al Jazeera Arabic, of course. It should be different. I mean, Al Jazeera Arabic is addressing Arab audience, 70% of its reporting about the Arab world. And guess what? These stories that we are reporting, either civil wars or massacres or crimes or genocides or these kind of issues. So the screen itself is not, doesn't have the luxury of distancing itself from the scene, like Al Jazeera English, which is reporting to the entire world and newsrooms scattered all over the world. Of course, Al Jazeera English has the headquarter in Doha, but the major newsroom is in London, and the other one is in Washington, and the third one is in Kuala Lumpur. And therefore, the international global perspective that Al Jazeera English has does not have the same tone or enthusiasm like Al Jazeera Arabic, simply because Al Jazeera Arabic are carrying stories that are extremely violent in a way or another, and emotional, and full of frustration, be it the witnesses, be it the newsmakers, the analysts, or the commentators. All of them has this kind of zeal that eventually will feature on the screen as very, you know, emotional and forthcoming performance. On the issue of whether Al Jazeera and Qatar are, just to correct what you have said, Al Jazeera English and Al Jazeera Arabic belong to the same organization. I used to be the director general of both of them. So Al Jazeera Arabic and Al Jazeera English receive the same funding from the state of Qatar. They belong to the same management. There is a central line of reporting, which both of them are exactly, you know, if there will be something of relationship with Qatar, it is equal. But the issue is not that. The issue that Al Jazeera, when it was launched, you know, the major concept of it was to introduce professionalism to the news in the Arab world. And that was done through journalists. Most of them came from BBC, and they continue to report. Now, will the state of Qatar use or wish to use Al Jazeera as a voice for its policy? If they have done so, Al Jazeera would have never been as prominent as it is today, because it would have sacrificed long time ago its credibility and could have become like any. We have, by the way, tens of channels in the Arab world, and some of them are richer than Al Jazeera. But they could not feature. Why? Because they were tied to a political agenda. So the simple argument that I will have with officials in Qatar, with the Prime Minister of Qatar, who used to be critical of Al Jazeera, with many people who would love Al Jazeera to be a little bit much across the editorial line, that your investment in this network will collapse the moment that this network takes a decision to embrace your point of view. The 15 years of a struggle to have this name of Al Jazeera could collapse in 15 days once Al Jazeera becomes the mouthpiece of the government of Qatar, which is true. I believe in it. And this is why you should, as a director general or head of news, make sure that there is a distance between what politics is all about and what the news is all about. Always, my role, I used to see it, I am the zone between the political pressure and the actual professional journalists, so they don't even have to know about the pressure. And here I'm not only referring to pressure that could come from the region, pressure that came from international society, pressure that came from Americans. At least the Americans bombed us in Iraq and bombed us in Afghanistan. They were plotting to bomb us in Doha, you know, and they killed some of our correspondents and they put some of them in Guantanamo. So it was really very severe. Would you bow for the American pressure because they are putting pressure on you? You resign. I would have resigned or quit the moment I feel that I have reached the point where I cannot really manage the pressure. But you cannot betray your message. And that was actually a solution that I personally proposed one day when we were put under severe conditions by the Americans in 2004. I said, that to the state of Qatar, the only thing that we could do is to have a press conference and to announce to the world that we cannot handle the profession anymore because of the American pressure. Therefore, we decided to close down Al Jazeera. Besides that, impossible to continue. Yeah.
Thanks very much. We now go to Beirut, to Sander. I think with the interesting, important question from a journalist, and the many, I think, students of journalism here, so that's an important question about to what extent do journalists from maybe competing media help each other? And then added to that, a question I have myself, how do you deal with basically, I mean, the danger, the threats that you face sometimes on a daily basis in that environment.
Yeah,
Well, one of the things you can do to deal with the threat and is by cooperating. And I can only speak for myself and the people I cooperate with, but the level of cooperation is actually very high, especially when it comes to security. When I'm in Egypt covering demonstrations which might end up in violence, I call my colleagues of the commercial television, of the newspapers, and they call me, where are you, what's the situation? You see people on the roof with things they shouldn't hold, stuff like that. So there the cooperation is very high. People can always call me. I know I can always call people who are in a country where I want to go. What is the best approach? What did you take? Is it safe to take a flak jacket through customs? Stuff like that. So the level of cooperation, and I guess it must have been the same when you were in Bosnia, is very high. The competition only kicks in, I dare say, when it concerns tomorrow's story. I won't tell them that, but anything else, I will. I will share, and especially when it comes to security.
Thank you very much, and I'm sure that's reassuring also to the students of journalism. We go to the next round of questions, and I've sort of neglected this block. No, you have asked already a question, so you won't get another turn. I see a gentleman there. Is you ask a question?
Yeah, thank you. It's a question for Sander. My name is Rauf Musad. I'm from Egypt. I'm not Muslim or Muslim brother. So we Arabs, and Sander know that, believe always in international plot against us. Yeah. And we believe so much now there is international plot against Syria to divide it for the sake of the main players in Middle East, especially Israel. What do you think? Thank you.
Okay. Then we go to the next question. Do we see any hands raised? See a lady here, over there, and then come to you.
This is also for Sander.
Could you give us your name and affiliation, please?
Yeah, my name is Fleur. I'm a Dutch student as well, journalism. And I'm thinking about writing my thesis about this subject, so for me this is a nice way to ask if it's a good subject. How much do you depend on social media like YouTube and Twitter and Facebook, and how important is it, or how do you check who uploaded this, and how do you check your sources on social media?
Okay, thank you for that question. And we have a lady here right in the front. Make you exercise a little bit. He's already extremely fit.
Yasmin Jawad, Iraqi origin, Dutch nationality, Arab sociologist.
Can you keep the microphone a little bit closer?
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I don't know. No. Do you hear me? Yes? Sure. Oh, please. Short question. Al Jazeera covers almost or focus in the Arab world, but never focus on the Qatarian politics. That's all.
Okay, we take one more question for this round. Anyone who's upstairs who would like to ask a question has to come down, unfortunately. There in the back.
Question to Marwan, and maybe what I want to react to. To what extent does Al Jazeera plays a role in the civil war of Syria? We all know that the Qatar government supports the opposition and give them weapons. And another thing, several times Al Jazeera showed pictures from the head cuttings of Mexico or pictures from Iraq, but said that it was from Syria. Is it deliberate, or do you check the pictures?
Thanks for that question, and it will be an interesting answer to that. Now we first go to Sander. I think it was you got the question.
Yeah, and yeah. The second question was more or less in line with the last question, so I'll answer that secondly, so the other people can react. About Israel and the role in the region. Well, there is a lot of conspiracy theories. I know a lot of them. I heard quite a few after the bombing of the Iranian embassy. And well, first of all, sometimes you just don't know. And then you can discuss the plausibility of things. For example, after the bombing of the Iranian embassy, Israel being behind it at that time, it didn't look likely to me. Same as with Syria. What do I know? I know that, for example, Israel seemed to be quite happy with Bashar al-Assad for a long time. So why would that have changed to the extent that they want to divide Syria? Would it be in their interest? If I decide that it could be in their interest, it might be making it more plausible that they are behind it. But in the end, I don't deal with conspiracy theories. I deal with facts. And if I don't know something, the only thing I can do is be modest in my claims, be modest in my context, be modest in my reporting. So I will opt not to report on such a thing if I don't have proof. But that is a difficult thing because when it concerns Israel and the apparatus they have at hand, sometimes something very far-fetched might actually be true. That's also something which has been proven in the past. And so you get a mix of things that decide whether or not you report on something. But concerning Syria, I'm not sure if that conspiracy theory is something I would follow at this moment. Then the social media. Any social media is a source, and where that applies, like the basic journalistic principles, how you treat sources. But it's something more that can be said, for example, about Twitter. There's a lot of people I follow, and you develop a relationship with people. So some sources are more equal than other sources. For example, here in Lebanon, we have a SMS service which is known for its canards. So they report things that turn out very much to be untrue later, but it does give you a heads up. So that's the way I treat, for example, that source. YouTube is a very special case because you have a very hard time verifying where it comes from, if it's authentic. And at the same time, we are more and more dependent on YouTube videos, especially from people like Alexander from the north of Syria, because, and that's a very worrying trend, for most international journalists now it's too dangerous to enter Syria. I mean, colleagues of mine, Dutch colleagues, international colleagues, who are very experienced in region, experienced in assessing danger, they don't go anymore. They know that they will be kidnapped as soon as they cross the border. And that's worrying because for our coverage of the northern part of Syria, we rely more and more again on YouTube videos. And that's very hard to estimate where they come from, if they are authentic, who sent them, stuff like that. So, but you do try. And there's sometimes, and I will finalize with that, a very nice trend on social media trying to collaborate verifying videos. Brown Moses, for example, is one who does a very good and, in my case, unmissable job at that.
Okay, thanks very much. So we learned some sources are more equal than others. There's one big animal farm over there.
Yep.
Then we go to Marwan. I think you also had a question.
Yes. Yeah. So the question was about the involvement of Al Jazeera in Syria. I think that was the main question. So I want to go back to my main point, which is that every news organization has a narrative. Did Al Jazeera take sides in Syria? Of course it did. If you watch it for a couple of days, there's no doubt in anybody's mind that it did. Why? I don't know for a fact. I do know that it has something to do, at least a small thing to do, with the stance of the government that sponsors it. There's no doubt in my mind. If you study the media for as long as I do, that's a non-starter. That's one. Two, I think the issue of authentication is truly important. Sander just mentioned Brown Moses. I mean, the fact that a blogger in the United Kingdom who has no training in weapons and who has no training in the Middle East and who has no training in journalism becomes a key source on weapons in Syria should at least lead us to take a breath and ponder the implications, at the very least. That's my job. As an academic, I have the luxury of saying, my deadline is not tomorrow, my goal is not to break the story, my goal is to understand what's going on over patterns over a long time, right? So when I hear this, I take a breath and I pause and I follow certain things. Yes, people who are dedicated to one very narrow task very often can have insight that many other people don't have just because they're so focused, laser focused on one task. But I do think this fragmentation of sources, this displacement of the act of witnessing that journalists should do and are expected to do. Yes, it's very dangerous, but that should not be an excuse for shoddy reporting. Yes, it's scary to go in, and yes, you deal with pressures. You get shot at, and you might choose not to go in. Some institutions that do not send their journalists in rein in their coverage accordingly. But unfortunately, some others, without reporters on the ground, keep going with their narrative, with the burden of proof being less and less. Many news organizations, including Al Jazeera, did show videos that turned out to be false, whether deliberately fabricated or by mistake. Where the mistake happened, I don't have the evidence to show, but yes, we've seen them on Al Jazeera and on many other outlets. So again, I go back to my main issue, which is you cannot substitute the presence of journalists on the ground. For as long as we are forced to do this, there's a very serious problem, and everything should be taken with not a grain, but a rock of salt, of doubt.
Mm-hmm. True, but can I add something to that?
Yes, briefly, please.
Yeah. Okay, well, there's also a downside to being on the ground, and it should also make you very modest. For example, if I'm in a big crowd or in a fight, I know I can see 100 meters in front of me and 100 meters to the sides of me, and that's the extent to which I can report. So yes, that's very important, but you shouldn't idealize it as being the only way you can report. I mean, a journalist is trained, a good journalist, in weighing sources. Brown Moses is never the single source, but as a source, it can be a very good one. So don't overestimate being on the ground. It's very important, especially combined with other sources.
Thanks very much for that useful nuance. Wadah.
Before we start, just to answer the question with the lady here, study history. Journalism is a skill, but not substance. I'm sorry. The skill of journalism, to go to the school of journalism when you graduate with them, doesn't make you a journalist with great, vision. In fact, I do believe that it provides you with the skills, provides you with techniques. You need to have the substance to acquire it through history, proper analysis, that you choose certain magazines and certain writers who write in depth about politics, that you will acquire the talent of analysis, and therefore you could become a great journalist indeed. Now, let me go to the issue of two questions were asked about Qatar and about Syria. Now, Qatar is a tiny state in the Arab world that consists of 250,000 population. And Qatar is much less small than Emirates next to it, and Kuwait next to it, and Oman, and many other countries in the Gulf. I think if someone makes a study, he will find that Qatar was covered more than Emirates, more than Oman, for example, which is much bigger than it. So it is not true. The word focus is wrong to use in this concern. We don't have something called we focus on. There are events in a country that we cover. But to say that we choose a country that we will focus on, that is not a professional attitude and should not happen anyway. The issue of Syria, I am not aware. I have served in Al Jazeera 8 years, and I was in charge of everything that was appearing all the screens of Al Jazeera. I am not aware ever that Al Jazeera, during at least the course of my service, ever, and I challenge, because I'm sure about it, and this is a historical responsibility, ever Al Jazeera broadcast a single frame of beheading on its screen, Arabic or English or Balkan or Turkish or any other language that we broadcast. Never. That was a taboo that Al Jazeera respected. Now, certain circumstances led to certain kind of mistakes. We had the courage of appearing on the screen saying that this tape was wrong, and we apologize to our audience, simply in a region where you are deprived from sources of news from its authentic locations, you may fall in the trap of someone smuggling something into your news bulletin through a mistake, but never that we discover that the news item or the videotape was wrong and we don't have the courage to appear on the screen and to say, sorry, that was wrong, that was shot somewhere else. What you are referring to, I am not aware at all. I have left Al Jazeera 2 years ago, and this tape that you are referring to, I saw it myself on YouTube, but I know, and later on it was, of course, proven that it is from, not from Syria, but I doubt that Al Jazeera would ever broadcast something like that, simply because our code of conduct that all of us follow does not allow Al Jazeera to broadcast scenes of beheading, which was very terrible, as I have seen it. Now, just a last statement about Syria in particular. and whether we were actually following the Qatari agenda. Qatar was the closest ally to Syria in the Arab world. The closest at all, ever, emir or president or leader in the Arab world to Bashar al-Assad was the emir of Qatar and Erdogan of Turkey, if you remember, long time ago, before the when the revolution started. Qatar had good relationship with Zain al-Abidin ibn Ali in Tunisia, had good relationship with Hosni Mubarak, and had good relationship with Mubarak, with Qaddafi. And that didn't lead our coverage to follow the Qatari foreign policy. In my opinion, it is actually not historically correct that Al Jazeera on revolutions did follow the Qatari track. If you will really study it carefully, you might find the opposite. I think Al Jazeera created awareness. Did we support revolutions in the Arab world as a TV station? Yes, we did. We did. Did we support a certain element within these revolutions, Ikhwan Muslim Brotherhood, or leftists, or rightists, or Sunnis, or Shia? No, we did not. In general, we did support the feeling amongst the public in the Arab world to liberate themselves from tyranny and dictatorship. And that is part of our mission, as it was in 2004 declared to the world, that we stand for democracy, freedom of expression, and the right of people for knowledge. And in a region like ours, I would say that supporting democratic transformation is a necessity. But to taking a side with someone against the other is something different. To defend journalists arrested is a necessity. But to take a step against others, politicians without any, is not actually a role of a journalist, a role of a political party rather than the journalist. So in short, I would say Al Jazeera over the last 15 years was one of the major reasons that led to the revolution of the Arab world, or the so-called Arab Spring, because of the awareness that is spread and the fact that Arab world start to feel that they could, when they have a voice, really influence the reality.
Okay, thank you. We go now for a last round of questions. First to the balcony. It's actually the first time we do it, but we have our very fit colleague who's up with the microphone. I can't see anything. Are there any questions from upstairs? Okay. Now you have an opportunity. Short questions, no statements,
yes.
Please.
Sana Fordman, I want to ask Wadah Khanfar. Can you tell me about the freedom or the democracy, what Al-Qaeda and Jabhat al-Nusra give Syrian people? Can you tell me that these people, can the freedom give to Syrian people?
Okay.
I ask you, what do you think? Okay. If Al-Qaeda or Jabhat al-Nusra, the women in Syria can give the freedom?
Okay, that's a question. Thank you very much. Sounded a little bit like a statement too. We go, is there another question up there? Can't see anything. Where's the mic? Hurry up.
This is a question maybe for all three guests.
Can you please give us your name and affiliation?
My name is Yassin. I'm not a journalist. I'm just I'm just political aware. I think JFK, he had a speech about secret societies, and he invited all journalists, and he talked about secret societies, and he asked journalists to respect their jobs in all the things they did, basically warning for big companies and politics. Politicians influencing journalists.
Is there a question coming?
Yeah, it's coming right now. Okay. So how do you think that's going on right now? Because you talked about the power holders who are actually trying to influence journalists.
Okay, I hope you got the question. We go one to the floor here. A question, sorry, you were already, do we have anyone down here? Okay, next to the gentleman. I think it came together as a duo, so you have a list of questions there, I'm sure.
Thank you. Yeah, one question to Mr. Khanfar again. I would like to ask you about one of your most respected and most successful journalists during your time as Director General of Al Jazeera. And of course, I'm talking about Mr. Benjeddu. He was even so popular that he was mentioned as one of your potential successors as director general at Al Jazeera. But a few years ago, he resigned.
From Al Jazeera. We don't need a CV here, sorry.
No, it's not a CV. It's just some respect for that man.
Of course.
But he resigned a few years ago, and he said that he resigned because he found Al Jazeera not being independent enough about the correspondence of the Arab Spring. How do you react to an allegation like that from one of your most respected journalists?
Okay, thanks very much. Then we do have another question upstairs. Is there a mic up there or not? There's not a microphone upstairs, is there? It's downstairs, you're downstairs. Okay, then stay downstairs. The lady there with the scarf.
Hi, I'm Leah Cowan. I work in NGO work, often in emergency response. And I was wondering what your relationship is with NGOs overseas. Do you feel that they're a credible source, or do you feel sometimes they're guilty of exaggerating the humanitarian situation on the ground?
Okay, thanks very much. Now we go to the panel. Well, Wadah.
Okay, you know, the issue, what do I think about Al-Qaeda is really a strange question to be asked to me, yani personally. But anyway, what I think about Al-Qaeda, it is the worst thing that is happening in for this noble and magnificent and beautiful revolution against the tyranny of Bashar al-Assad and his regime. It is really something very bad. But the only thing I would say in this case, every one of us, including myself, I have written many articles before this phenomenon of Al-Qaeda in Syria appeared, and we said, if the world let this revolution down, then the next phase is going to be Al-Qaeda coming into Syria. And this is unfortunately was self-fulfilled prophecy that the Americans from the beginning were speaking about. The second issue, Al-Qaeda itself will be dealt by the Syrians themselves. I don't think the Syrian people, which is known as a moderate nation, will accept Al-Qaeda to lead them in the struggle. And as we talk today, a lot of groups who are fighting Bashar al-Assad are actually at the same time very, you know, not comfortable with the presence of Al-Qaeda, and some fighting even took place between factions supporting the revolution and Al-Qaeda. So Al-Qaeda, in a way or another, came because there was really something happening in Syria, and there was reluctance from the international society, especially the Americans, who did not allow the rebels to acquire quality weapons at the beginning of the revolution. Now, second issue related to, what was the second question? Forget the second question. The journalists? Yeah, the journalist who has resigned. We had few people who resigned. Not one. We had 10 people who resigned from Al Jazeera. But in the context of 5,000 journalists or 5,000 employees working for Al Jazeera. So people have opinion. And as I told you, the Arab world went through huge polarization. Some people did not feel comfortable with certain kind of reporting because they have their own opinion about what should happen. And eventually the judge for that would be the newsroom itself, the editorial policy, and the integrity of the newsroom. So I would say that some journalists didn't like it and they left, and that was fantastic. I mean, I don't mind. And I think appreciate if someone doesn't like what he thinks doing, he should resign. But in general, we had, as I told you, 5,000 employees who were working for Al Jazeera, and I don't count more than 5 or 6. It is not true, the figure that Ernesto read in the beginning, the 20 who resigned in Egypt, although that happened 2 months ago, I was not in Al Jazeera after the coup immediately. Most of them did resign because of the pressure came to them from the new situation emerging in Egypt, not necessarily because they were really protesting against Al Jazeera. And according to my knowledge, most of them came back to Al Jazeera now.
Marwan, would you like to respond to
I think that it's the truth is somewhere in between. I do think that the fact that the Beirut bureau chief, who had one of the primary responsibilities for covering Syria, resigned is a little more meaningful and significant than just a basic disagreement on things. I do think it reflects at least a struggle within the institution about how to cover Syria. So I think, and we have, you know, clearly it's as Wadah said earlier. People who are covering areas and countries with which they have relationship that are more intimate, for instance, I mean, Sander mentioned, you know, he has sort of the luxury of being an outsider. Many of these journalists don't have that luxury. So sometimes you're covering a country or a city that's being bombed You might have family members in it. And that creates all kinds of issues. But I do think there were struggles within news organizations about how to cover stories. And we saw, sure enough, I mean, Mr. Benjiddu didn't only resign, but he headed a new channel. That in many ways now, on some issues, sounds like Al Jazeera of 10 years ago. So it's a very complicated field. People have disagreements. People have agendas. Some of them leave and stay quiet. Others leave with more noise and create competitors. And I think ultimately that's a good thing.
Thanks very much. Sander, in Beirut, you were away for a short while because we were trying to see if we could get Rami back on screen, but it didn't work with the connection. Do you have any comment on this?
Well, there was one question about the relation with NGOs. For me, that's a funny question because my wife works for one, so that's quite simple. And NGOs, well, our agendas converge in most of the cases because they work with people and we want to tell their story. So that's a good cooperation. Now, there is, of course, the agenda of NGOs, which is in most of the cases money. And I got into an argument with some NGOs when I claimed that in Lebanon, for example, now...
Not with your wife, I hope.
No. She provided actually some interesting information I could use in my claim that money was was less of an issue than finding the right people. So when NGOs start claiming they need more money, then that's something you have to be wary about. But in general, I would say that the cooperation, especially in the field between journalists and people of NGOs, is a very good one. Now, the influence was another topic that was raised. I don't think there's a lot of influence by big companies on my level. You would have to talk to my editor-in-chief. And finally, I would like to... hoe noem je dat? Uit de school klappen. I would like to tell the leader of the discussion that there's a woman called Fleur in the zaal, in the room, and she is asking questions through Twitter. So she's trying to bypass you, just to let you know.
Okay, great. The use of social media. Yeah, very good. By the way, this whole session is being streamed live. So we are moving into the 21st century. Okay, thanks very much. I think we have to leave it to that. If you have more questions after that. Well, normally I don't give in to that. The lady, no, you had your chance. So you won't get... No, sorry, I can't give you an opportunity. That will lead to chaos and revolution and stuff. I'll make one exception for you. But there's a heavy responsibility on you to ask a very good question. Eh?
Okay. My name is Belmeki. I don't have any background in journalism. I'm actually active in the financial services. I was wondering...
Very popular.
I could imagine that there... That the media structure, for example, like Al Jazeera, is under pressure from both sides. And by both sides, I mean from the one side, the financial institutions who invest in media structures, and on the other hand, the political incentives. And I was wondering, how does a media structure deal with those pressures from both sides?
Okay.
Actually, we did not have. I was speaking about journalism in general, because Al Jazeera was lucky that it didn't have really an economic crisis, because it was funded, it's still funded by the state of Qatar. So financially, we didn't really have that kind of pressure at all. But I was referring to the concept of commercialization of the news all over the world. Most likely, when you pick up major corporations right now who deal with the news, they do really take the commercial considerations sometimes above the editorial considerations. And that's what was really scary, because in this case, news becomes a commodity in order to make money rather than to break the truth or even to narrate the truth or to do something about it.
Well, thank you very much. I think a lot of us are thinking about other considerations, like maybe thirst. The bar is going to open soon. but I would like to, Sander, sorry you can't join us, but I offer you a sort of virtual beer from here.
Or I will drink a beer to all of your health.
You can come down here when you're in Holland and pick up your sort of token of appreciation from our side, which we want to support by a very warm round of applause. Also, of course, for our speakers. Thank you very much. I also would like to thank very much Rami Jarrah, who has been with us, but the connection wasn't very good. I think he could hear it, and he can definitely see it over by streaming, because the whole session is being streamed, as I said. I would also like to thank very much the Rode Hoed and the two persons, my colleagues, Jessica Kaljau and Wim, who carried the microphones. And last but not least, of course, Marco van Riel, who's sitting somewhere up there, trying to put a slide instead of the face of Sander. And of course, we have to do it in a bit more, I think, tangible way, express our thanks. Now, the big book, but that's nothing to do with size, goes to Khanfar. It's about the Netherlands. Well, you have to read. It's a very big book. So on the way back or wherever you're going next, to Brazil or something.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now this I've kept for Marwan because it's by Russell Short, the island at the center of the world. It's about Dutch Manhattan. So you live in the States, so you can see basically what was the beginning, the origin. Well, not really the origin, but at some point it was Dutch. Yeah. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
And then now you're all invited to join us, have a drink here. If you have some more questions, you can approach both of our speakers. Thank you very much. See you again. Okay. Thanks very much.
Too bad.